my true blue.
How are you going, folks? I'm often asked what happens behind the scenes, you know, like how do songs come to be written? Or how do they come to sound like they do? Well, I've got to tell you, after 27 years in the business, my mind is a bit of a songwriting machine. In other words, I'm always looking for that idea, and it's usually just one line, you know, like All Australian Boys Need a Shed. I mean, that's all you have to hear, you know straight away there's a song there.
Yeah, all Australian boys need a shed, a place where he can go, somewhere to clear his head.
It's not only, of course, ideas that start songs, it's often rhythms or feels. Like behind stage, I find that I'm often messing about with a guitar, kind of a nervous state before I go on stage and there will be feels that will come to me then, and I'll try and find words to fit that, and that sometimes will end up being a song. I think Tubbo Station in the past that I wrote was that came from that kind of thing.
Never seen it so green round Tubbo Station. Old man Saltbush never been so blue.
A good example of on Pipe Dream of a song that really did start with a feel is the one called Blues Sometimes. I was actually working on a little feel on the guitar, which is dun 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 dun. You know, I'm always discovering new little things. You know, I don't regard myself as a Tommy Emmanuel on the guitar, and I'm probably a little bit lazy on the guitar, so I'm forever discovering new things that probably are really old to someone like Tommy. And when I find something new, it can often inspire me as a writer. I have tried a few tunings, changing the tuning on the guitars, and that inspires songs as well. And a good example of that on this album is Rosewood Hill. Now, I've tuned the guitar to a C chord, if I remember rightly. And I discovered with that tuning there is a kind of a down in the swamp or up in the mountains, hillbilly kind of a feeling to it. And it was perfect for the idea that I wanted to write about the fact that that we're losing all our so much of our hinterland. You know, in other words, the old farmers that used to try and make a quid out of farming or growing flowers or whatever they did up in the mountains is slowly but surely disappearing, especially anywhere near an airport or anywhere near a tourist destination. And I got a bit of land up in the southeast of Queensland, and I've bought it for that purpose, to make sure that the White Coast gold shoes, as I put them in tongue-in-cheek, don't get hold of it, because I believe once they do get hold of it, all those wonderful places we go to visit won't be there any longer. And the reason the guest houses and wonderful little curiosity shops and stuff that you find in those places, once all that the farming land is divided up into quarter acre blocks, or they start with 20 acres, 10 acres, 5 acres, and it always happens. Once they start, they become little suburbs, and once that happens, well, you lose what the charm of the place was in the beginning. It's a difficult one to explain how I write a song. I mean, I guess it's a bit like asking a painter, you know, why he puts the next brushstroke on the canvas. You know, it's a bit hard to explain. But a lot of the songs I do write, I get a great line comes up. You know, here's me, a songwriter, I can't think of a great line, but power over me. You have a power over me. Well, that was an idea that came to me because, okay, things aren't always rosy in a marriage, and there was a bit of an argument or something, and you know, I don't think us men are as strong as women sometimes, and I'm positive that Mary Kay has a power over me. And I, anyway, well, where it comes from there, and then I say, well, you have a power over me. There's a melody, there's a rhythm there already. You'll notice in the song that I don't change the rhythm of the words.
You have a power over me, 'cause I love.
Yeah, well, Pipe Dream is it's one of my favourites on the album. The rhythm for this, it changed quite a bit. The original rhythm, I think, was too quick or something, and it never really conjured up what it was like out there amongst these old fellas that didn't work all that hard, that had a bit of a, what would you call it, a humpy, you know, out there. You don't have to build a permanent, well, you're not supposed to build a permanent house on your opal claim. And it suits a lot of these old fellas who are retired DMR fellas who have, you know, who've spent a lot of time around the campfire along on the side of the road, I guess, and old drovers. And they're not the kind that want to end up in an old home, you know. They much prefer die sitting on a stump, I think, you know. And so to get that kind of feeling of these old blokes that do what they want to do and work when they want to work, I just didn't get it in the music for quite a while, but eventually we did come up with a rhythm that I think is, whilst it describes something that is the last frontier, it also is quite contemporary as well, and that's a real fun song to perform.
It's a pipe dream, but it's the right dream for me.
Yeah, I don't like to have rules in songwriting or in producing music. I mean, there are natural things, I guess, that you do because you don't want to put people off, you know. Like, you let the songs flow naturally, and that comes from probably the way we've heard music over the years, or the way, you know, the natural music that's in our system. I believe, for instance, that, you know, me having mainly Celtic kind of blood, that I love those kind of Celtic rhythms, which country music is based on, really. A good example of a lot of sounds that we used that just were around about us when we were recording the Bush Telegraph. When I first heard the song, it was sung by a bush band called Bush Fire. And as this TV show was about to come out that I'm involved in called Bush Telegraph, and they got up and sang this song, I thought, well, this is perfect. It's a dream come true. We'll have to approach them and ask them who wrote it. And it took us about 3 months to find the bloke who wrote it, or one of the blokes who wrote it. But as soon as I heard it, then they talk about thingamajigs and whizzing around the moon. It was a definite opening there for a bit of silliness. And so I had one of the instruments, I can't think what they call, a swanee whistle or something. So I whacked that in, of course, in one place. And we're talking about a jam tin cut in half, so we scurried around the studio for a jam tin. I think I found an old coffee tin. It was full of pencils. Threw the pencils out and hit it with the back of a scrubbing brush or something, and that made a perfect noise. Well, and the noises that I've made with my mouth, I guess that's something I've always done all my life. I don't know why. I think I had a grandfather that was into making silly noises and... But I enjoy making cat noises and dog noises and what else are we having that? Chook noises. Bomb. Well, the bomb was an interesting one to get that. I wanted it to sound like a homemade bomb, which probably wasn't too big, but it went off somewhere out in the shed. So someone came up with the idea that we'd try bursting a balloon. Well, we burst about 6 balloons and realised that was too. It was too short. It just went pop. But then we found we got a bigger noise if Robin, our assistant, blew the thing up till it burst. That was like a bigger bop. But then we slowed it down to make it a little bit more gutsy. So these days, with all the different gadgets you've got on recording machinery, it's incredible what you can do while you're speeding up or slowing down. Like so many writers, I think, in Australia, bush songwriters have written songs about drought and written songs about floods and bushfires and all, you know, I guess making romantic the tough times. But I think it's a bit... It is time we also celebrate the good times, you know. They go hand in hand.
Yeah, things are on the improve out here. Hey, it's good to see the country people smiling.
The year I wrote on the improve was 96, and it was around about spring, and we were out central west New South Wales, and I'd never seen so much wheat crops and so much good quality wheat crops. being an ex-wheat farmer, I noticed these things. And as it turned out, the quality of the wheat was fantastic right up well into Queensland. And in fact, my brother and all the people around Cropper Creek that I know from when I used to farm up there have all had the biggest crops they've ever had in their lives. Like when the average wheat crop over, say, 30 years is probably two-thirds of a tonne, they're getting more like 2 tonne to the acre. So things, to me, seem to be on the improve. And I know from living in a little bush town just how much difference it makes to all the shopkeepers. And we often sing about the farmers going bad. We never think about the poor old little business people in the towns, the people who sell the tractors and sell the fuel and fertilisers and you know, the auctioneers and you name it, the cute beautician. They're all there hoping that the farmers will have a good year. And, you know, half the time the stores are giving credit to the farmer for 12 months before they get their money and so on. So all of a sudden the farmers have got their money and the old fella's bought himself a new car that owns the store. And I've enjoyed recording this song, and probably when the thing's released there'll be another drought. But that's all right. I'm singing Galleries of Pink Galahs, you know, whether it's a good year or a bad year, so I don't see why I shouldn't be the other way around.
Yeah, things are on the improve out here.
I wrote Coolabah Blue on the way to the Opal Fields. I was actually on the way out to the Opal Fields to do a couple of my favourite episodes on Bush Telegraph. I was very busy up to that point, and I was quite a relief to actually still go out working, but to get on the road, and because it was a 7 or 8 hour drive to get to Lightning Ridge, and I was pretty tensed up, you know, most of the drive until I got out to around about Walgett, where the Namoi and the Barwon Rivers virtually meet there, and they're in flood. And I love Coolabahs because they're so blue. You know, the blue of the Coolabahs, especially when they've had water over their roots, they're just looking so wonderful. And I've often mentioned Coolabahs. Of course, it's a classic song word, the old Coolabah being in Waltzing Matilda.
With the blue Coolabah and the red sunset and the green Mitchell grass, I'll stay. Right before my eyes, I see the...
I was so pleased that the song Coolabah Blue came up because I was looking for a campfire song, and I'm always determined that I do keep in touch with what we call the Australian traditional bush ballad, you know, in the genre of Stan Coster and Buddy Williams and so on.
Publican has turned out the light. Just a little frog on a river log looking for a fight.
Another good reason for 3 years between albums, whether it'll be 3 years for the next one, I don't know, but one of the good reasons is to give myself time to research. I can no longer rely on my past, like I have, I think in the past I've relied on my farming background and my childhood and what I call travelling songs or road songs or windscreen songs. That's what I call them, windscreen songs, that you write just by whizzing around between town to town when I'm actually doing the show. So I'm researching a lot more, actually going to places, and a good example of that was when Tony Dennett and I did in fact go to the Opal Fields, and in particular we went to Grawen, which is around about an hour inland from Lightning Ridge in the northwest of New South Wales. And we, Diesel Bob had allowed us to use his campsite, and he had a bit of a shed, and we just strung up a bit of a canvas and put out a couple of shearers' cots and threw the mattresses on, and it was great. It didn't rain or anything, and lived around the campfire for a week. But every night we went into the local pub. There's two local pubs, and there's a club. There's a bush club, and there's the Glengarry Hilton, which could easily be mistaken for a chookyard. Well, it was back then. They've improved a bit now, but it's great. It's the atmosphere that they love out there, and it's the atmosphere that we love to go to. It just fills up with amazing characters in the evening. And same with the sheepyards. They call it the hotels the sheepyards, and they're only around about, 5 kilometres apart or something, if that, maybe 3 kilometres apart. But the roads are that rough. It takes a fair while to get there, you know, and if you can find it. because it's easy to get lost. Everywhere you look, there's just little gravelly tracks that are made up out of opal diggings, you know, going through the bush, and they all look the same, and they're all going in all different directions. One of the funny things that happened was that Tony and I went to the sheepyards one night, and we had a few beers, and I can tell you there's no breathalyzer out there. They wouldn't know which road to sit on. But I left, and the bloke, the proprietor, didn't know, you know, who I was. Not that means anything, but we, you know, just got on like everybody else, and I took off, and he directed us down there. You follow down there, see those power poles, well, take that track there, and this, that, and I observed as many things as I could on the way there, but they all looked different on the way back. And off we went to try and find our camp. Well, 20 minutes later, we figured that we had to get back to the pub. We certainly couldn't figure how to get... So back to the pub we went, and he gave us another direction, and away we went again, and I was getting a bit... I was getting a bit embarrassed because, you know, I regarded myself as a bit of a bushman, and we had to go and wake the bloke up again anyway. He closed the pub because we left when the pub was closed. We had to get him up again. Eventually, he had to shower. He had to drive there and show us how to get there. So he reckoned I was a so-and-so bushman if ever he saw one, you know. It was the next day. He said, "Oh, geez, you didn't tell me you're John. I didn't know you're John." I said, "Well, I don't care, mate, you know." But he still brings it up when we go out to the sheepyards that he had to show us how to get home. But so, I mean, all that while this is all this is happening, of course, there's being the old songwriter, you know, that got into the song, you know, 100 dusty tracks, you know, it's hard to find your way around. They all look the same. Tie a ribbon around a butterwood tree because all the trees, there's two lots of trees there, they're basically butterwood trees, or there's a iron bark or the broadleaf box, and you try to sort of pick out the odd bush and that and put your own sign on it, whether you tie a can to it or a ribbon. So that's where our camp is if you go around that tree there. But finding that tree is the hard one. But, and we soon discovered that a larger majority of the miners there weren't all that mad keen to work hard to find an opal. They enjoy so much just being there and living around the campfire and it's a way of life. And even the successful ones, I think half the time they know the opals are there, they'll leave them there until they need the money to buy their beer or supplies, and they'll do a bit more work just to get the money. As far as they're concerned, there's money in the bank. It's going up in value all the time underneath, you know, as long as the ratters don't get under there and get it. And there are a few ratters around, apparently. They're the ones that sneak in during the night and raid your mine. So, you know, just everywhere you turn, there's ideas for songs. You know, there could be a song about ratters, you know, now I'm thinking of it. And we went down. They all said, "You've got to go and meet Veggie Bill." Well, as I say in my show, that was a pleasure. We met Veggie Bill, and every can of beer I bought him, he had another story. And so I wrote about one of the stories. And they're just a bunch of great people who enjoy life. Well, that's where Pipe Dream came from. Of course, that's where Veggie Bill came from. They really are. They go hand in hand. Veggie Bill, as the story tells you, was really wanted to talk about the Kimberley, even though he was in a romantic spot right at the moment. He really wanted to talk about the Kimberley more than anything else, and it's where he was a greater driver for a long time, and he obviously loved the Aboriginal friends he had up there and the glorious countryside, you know. And he has actually got that picture book. You might have seen it on Bush Telegraph. And that's all he's got left because he's too crook to go back up there. So I was keen to hear everything he said about the Kimberley because we were about to go, and off we went later on that year, performing the show from Broome all the way through to Darwin. Fascinated very much so with the baobab trees. I saw the what they call the prison baobab tree, where there is a historical photo where they caught the notorious Aboriginal so-called criminal and chained them up to this prison tree, which is, you can go actually go inside it. The interesting thing about a bow tree is when they do hollow out in the middle, the bark then forms on the inside as well. So it's like it's a shell. You're actually, the tree is like a membrane with bark all around it on the inside as well. So it survives and lives on. And the reason I mention the baobab tree is I was always, you know, shocked by the idea that that history tells us that we used to chain Aborigines to baobab trees. But apparently, according to these old ringers I met, some of the young white fellows got chained to the baobab trees as well, and that was because there were no prisons up then. There was definitely police 50 years ago up there, but no prisons. So it was quite a common thing, if someone did something wrong, they would be chained to a tree. And if they're really bad, they'll make this chain short and all the rest of it. And Roy Walker was telling me this on his camp outside Kununurra. He's got this permanent camp on the spillway from the Argyle Dam, plenty of water, squatting on 250,000 acres. This is true. And so I was, Mary Kay and I were fortunate. This is when we're on the road after the tour. And with our camper van, we pulled up in there and stayed a couple of nights and listened to all their wonderful stories, fascinating and horrifying and all the rest of it, what it was like 50 years ago for young ringers. Both of them took off from Perth as young fellas. Just one took off, he's an orphan, and the other one, his old man, as I say in the song, treated him pretty harshly when he came back from war. So off they went, and apparently the head stockmen were really tough on them. If they were ever injured or something, that was just up to them to whack a bit of salt on it and worry about it, you know, and so on. Very proud old fellas, you know, very quick to tell you how good they still are on a horse or at stripping down a beast and handing you a plate of spare ribs in 5 minutes or something, you know. And that sort of stuff still goes on out there, of course. I mean, they use helicopters now. And I went on a helicopter ride, actually. At one stage, that was outside Kununurra. It took me half an hour to get sick, but apparently that happens to anyone that, unless you're the pilot, you know exactly which way you're going to go, because they really do fly those things around. Like, see a straggling beast, they're getting the beasts in, and they'll just do a backflip and go straight down towards it and, you know, hunt it with the helicopter. And if you're not ready for that, well, you know, your stomach doesn't go with you. And anyway, I said, you better put me down, otherwise I'm going to throw up into my hat, which he told me to do, you know. And I was crooked for a couple of hours then. While he's out getting these spare ribs, they bring them in and cook them straight off while they're still warm. And there's some delicacy. They all love these big, sloppy spare ribs while they're still warm, you know, cook them straight on. They guess they sort of go into a kind of a jelly because the meat hasn't set or something. And they all loved it. Oh, all the stockmen. Here's me feeling as crook as I've felt for years.
And I can still quarter a beast in a dash. Have your freezer full of spare ribs in a flash. And I still dream of the one for me, the prettiest girl in the Kimberley.
Wedding Ring, I think, and I can say this because I didn't write it, I think it's going to be regarded as the classic country wedding song. Pamela Drysdale wrote it. Pamela's a partner to Gary Steele, who's the keyboard player on the album. I heard her performing or rehearsing Wedding Ring with Gary at my own show rehearsal. And she wrote it for her own sister's wedding, who was, in fact, going back to the farm. They all came from Coonabarra Brand. They're all, I think there was three girls in the family, three or four, I'm not sure. And I heard a few lines of the song. I started to get a little bit teary just listening to her practicing it, and I thought, this has got to be a good song. I'd love to do it, Pamela. She thought, go ahead, I've written it just for this wedding, and she subsequently sang it to the whole family at the wedding, and they all howled, you know, which proof in the pudding that it is a great song, and I think a lot of country people will relate to it. There is this ongoing problem of losing our youth, especially the girls, to the city and to get away from the bush, and much to the disgruntled manhood around the place. We end up marrying school teachers and stuff. All the country girls leave.
Forever, and we wish you all the seasons of joy in your lives together.
The Wedding Ring is about a young girl who's going to become a woman on the land, and I have a huge amount of respect for the women on the land, especially in isolated areas. I think they're a special breed. They're still being born, because there's still a lot of people out in the farming districts in isolated areas. They have to be a bit of jack of all trades, and they have to. A lot of them do come from the city originally too, who probably initially don't like the idea of going out there, but then they have their family, and they do become attached, and I think they become, you know, do become the backbone of the country, you know, and I've always believed that. Women seem to be a little bit tougher when it comes to hard times. They seem to be able to handle things a little bit better. The men are the first to break down and so on. That seems to have been the way it happens generally. And, so it's the song is really a toast to the woman on the land. Yeah, Old Pancho was a man of the land. I don't really bring that out so much in the song, probably not at all. Old Pancho was my father-in-law, who recently passed away. He's had quite an adventurous and interesting background in the war, and sad, of course. He apparently escaped Changi. He found himself out in the middle of the ocean and saw ships going past, and you know, there's a lot of things he wouldn't explain too much about, but he had a horrific time getting away, I think, but he did finally get away. And when he finally came back to Australia and recouped, they whacked him on the guard duty at Cowra, and that happened during when the breakout happened, and he doesn't talk about that at all. We didn't talk about that. But more importantly, he was an affectionate old fella, and the reason he was nicknamed Pancho, I don't think too many ever said it in front of him, but he was nicknamed Pancho because he looked a bit Mexican or South American or something, you know. And I never saw him in a big sombrero, but his sons used to paint old Pancho on his tool shed and stuff like that, and have a bit of a laugh about it. He was a caring old fellow. Warren Williams is an Aborigine from Hermansburg, which is not far from Alice Springs. His father apparently has been a country and western singer, or a country singer, for a long time. Now, this is his son. It was suggested to him that he record Raining on the Rock. Someone out there suggested it to him. I think it was one of the radio station guys or something, you know. And they rang us up and said, well, what do I think about it? Like, actually doing a duo. And I thought, well, that's fantastic. You know, I've got a real feeling about Hermansburg, because that's where Albert Namatjira came from, and that was his town. And I have so much respect for Albert, and I actually mentioned him in Running on the Rocks. That all made sense. You know, Albert to me is the one who made us aware of the colours out there before we saw them ourselves.
Everlasting daisies and a beautiful desert rose. Where does their beauty come?
It took a little while for Warren to relax, but eventually he sang the song beautifully. And I discovered there's a quality in his voice. Whilst it sounds low, it is quite high, because I tried to sing above his voice with harmonies and stuff, and it just didn't work. And my voice, when I sang in a normal voice, it sounded lower than his, or if I tried to sing with him or something, it was too high. It's got a quality that that seems to have that's something that maybe is Aboriginal that we don't have, and I think we've brought that out in this song. And he's changed a few words, like, for instance, I said Uluru has power, he said Uluru is power, and I said, well, that's fair enough, you know. And there's a couple of lines there you'll notice, the people will know the song we changed to suit Warren, and I'm looking forward to the reaction.
It's raining on the rock. What am I decided to see? And I'm wishing and I'm dreaming that you were here with me.
Well, folks, it's not always easy to talk about my songs, because I try to put it all in the song. I haven't bored you with all this stuff. as you listen to them, you might get a bit more out of them, and I look forward to having a yarn with you anyway after the show. I'll see you along the road of the song.
Trading in the Commodore, the butcher and the cute beautician, the barber and the auctioneer, reckon that the town is moving.